यस प्रमोद, ऑल सेट?
यस सर, एवरीथिंग इज
ऑल
रेडी।
सेट?
यस ऑल
एवरीथिंग इज
सेट।
रेडी?
यस
ओके, वेल डॉक्टर पारसार्थी, यू आर म्यूटेड.
यस आई अनम्यूट।
प्रमोद, काइंडली अनम्यूट हिम एंड एनेबल हिम टू शेयर हिज स्क्रीन.
राइट सर।
सो अ ग्रैंड वेलकम डॉक्टर पारसार्थी.
थैंक यू।
And it was indeed what you call flute welcome to the
यस,
real artist
सो
of the
स्वीट ऑफ
flute,
यू।
to the real artist of the flute. And moreover, everything in Mahabharata was described by another person called Sanjay. So Sanjay is here in the form of a chairperson. So the entire Mahabharata has come up in this Sunday satsang.
Good evening, everybody.
Okay.
Yes. Is it clear at your end? Dr. Humaira Qureshi? Okay, Pramod. I
yeah.
think she has some problem with
okay.
connectivity.
Good evening, everybody. This is Pramod Dengle, event coordinator for April Sunday Literary Satsang. Professor G. A. Ghanshyam sir, founder and general secretary of ISPEL, Dr. Jyoti Patil, president of ISPEL, Dr. Kshamta Chaudhary, coordinator of ISPEL, and other executive members who are present here. On behalf of ISPEL, I take this opportunity to welcome everyone at this e-seminar of Sunday Literary Satsang. Indian Society for the Promotion of English Language and Literature is honored to have Parthasarathi Gupta as resource person, Department of English, Tripura University, Agartala. Chairperson of today's event, Dr. Sanjay Kumar Singh, Assistant Dean and Professor, Department of Humanities, OPJ University, Chhattisgarh. Mrs. Patriot Debamma, Assistant Professor of English, Tripura, as Master of Ceremonies. And Dr. Humaira Qureshi as Moderator from Nagpur. ISPEL is equally honored to have...
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Dr. Humaira... Yes, you are audible now. Not visible.
You continue, please.
Yes. ISPEL is equally honored to have our esteemed audience who are really here to get instructed and delighted. To begin with, I am privileged to introduce Dr. Humaira Qureshi, the moderator for today's satsang. She is a lecturer in English at Anna Sahib Gundewar College, Nagpur, Maharashtra. She is master's in English and doctorate from Nagpur University. With her spirit of learning, she did her MBA in Human Resource Management from IGNO. With her 14 years of teaching experience, she has got academically involved with her participation and paper presentation in national and international seminars and conferences. Besides a literary cult, she works as a soft skill trainer and organizes workshops for professionals. She has delivered talks as resource person and written several research articles published in national and international journals. Wishing you a great journey ahead, Dr. Humaira, I humbly invite you as moderator for today's event. Over to you, ma'am, please. Dr. Humaira Qureshi, please, over to you.
I think network connectivity is still an issue at her end, right?
Okay.
So, okay, I'll take the charge of Humaira Qureshi. Instead
right.
of Humaira Qureshi, I'll be introducing the Master of Ceremonies.
Sure, sir.
Friends, indeed, it's a great pleasure and honor to be on the platform of ISPEL. ISPEL, as you all know, is Indian Society for the Promotion of English Language and Literature, which not only facilitate people, but elevate also. We have with us today in the form of Master of Ceremony, Mrs. Petria De Burma. Mrs. Petria De Burma hails from Agartala in Tripura, and she is stationed at Udaipur. She is Assistant Professor of English for the past 10 years in Government Subhash Mahavidyalaya, Udaipur, and her area of interest includes feminist literature and Indian English literature. She is pursuing her PhD from Tripura University, Agartala. She has conducted many national and international seminars, and besides teaching, she also delivers talk on Akashvani, that is Agartala. She is very much interested and an emerging feminist because she is working on Cockburoch literature. Indeed, it's a honor and pleasure to have Petria De Burma, who is working for the community from which she hails, and she is also doing a lot of work in her area wherever she is teaching, that is known as Udaipur. So we welcome Petria on this platform as Master of Ceremonies to lead us to the destination. Over to Petria.
Thank you very much, Ghanshyam sir. Good evening to all the Icefellians. In its endeavor to illumine and enlighten the Indian minds, Icefell has today traversed every boundaries, physical or virtual. Icefell today boasts of 400 members consisting presence from India and abroad. And in its contemplation to indulge in its literary musings or the literary satsang that we have every week, Icefell has today reached its 28th event. And it is indeed an honor for me to be the Master of Ceremonies for today's Icefell event. And today we are to dwell on the topic, the anxiety of influence in literary research towards new methodologies of effect. If we are to talk about the anxiety of influence, my knowledge of this concept stems from Harold Bloom's famous work, The Anxiety of Influence, A Theory of Poetry, which was published in the year 1973. The book refers to the psychological struggle of aspiring authors to overcome the anxiety posed by the influence of their literary antecedents. And we are indeed aware how influence matters in our day-to-day life, how the influence of the parents, of the peers, of the elders are very important in order to shape the lives of young people. And therefore, the same kind of influence is definitely very phenomenal even in the areas of literary writings. And the book, The Anxiety of Influence by Harold Bloom, is also based primarily on Bloom's belief that there is no such thing as an original poem, that every new composition is simply a misreading or misinterpretation of an earlier poem, and that influence is unavoidable and inescapable. Therefore, all writers inevitably to some degree adopt, manipulate or alter and assimilate certain aspects of the content or subject matter, literary style or form from their predecessors. And therefore, today, let us look at how our resource person shall delve on this very critical issue, whether Dr. Parthasarathy Gupta, who teaches in the Department of English, Tripura University, Agartala, establishes this belief as Harold Bloom, or whether he would like to bring a new dimension to this topic, would be the main illumination of our young Icefellians today. It is indeed an honor for me to welcome and invite Dr. Parthasarathi Gupta, a teacher who is personally known to me. His areas of interest and specialization are theater studies, Indian aesthetics, modern critical theory, popular culture and literature, and Shakespeare scholarship and criticism. His alma mater is the University of Calcutta, from where he pursued both the BA and MA degrees. He has pursued his PhD on Indian English drama and urbanity under the supervision of Professor Himadri Lahiri, University of Burdwan, West Bengal. Besides, he takes keen interest in translating folk tales from India's northeast and Tripura in particular. His translations of the orators of Bongcher, Mraima, Chakma, and Tripuri communities have been established. It has been published by the Sahitya Academy, New Delhi, under the patronage of the Sahitya Academy Northeast Center for Oral Literature and Culture in anthologies dedicated to each community, respectively. He is a cinema buff, and his primary passion has always been teaching above everything else. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Parthasarathi Gupta, a teacher who is loved and revered by all in the Department of English, Tripura University, as the resource person of our today's iSpell event. You are most welcome, sir, and the stage is now yours.
Thank you so much, Patriot. Thank you for those kind words. At first, I would like to express my deep gratitude to iSpell and our team today, Dr. Sanjay Kumar Singh, Dr. Humaira Qureshi, Dr. Pramod Dengle, and above all, Professor Ghanshyam, who have been deliver a lecture today. And I must also, it would be a sin if I do not mention Dr. Prashanta Chakraborty, who actually inspired me to deliver this lecture today. So thank you, Prashantada, as well. Now, today here, I am no Harold Bloom here. I'm sorry to provide a rejoinder here to Patriot. Today, I'm here to address students, present and prospective researchers, on some aspects of research methodology. Now, I have observed that today, let me straight away come to my topic. As you can see on screen, that the title of my talk is The Anxiety of Influence in Literary Research Towards New Methodologies of Affect. I guess all of you can hear me clearly. If not, please inform me.
Yes, we can.
Yes. I'm here to address students, present and prospective researchers, on some aspects of research methodology. I have observed today that in the recent times, when students approach prospective supervisors for mentorship, they appear unschooled, uninitiated, uninspired, unmotivated, and sometimes uninformed on not their core area of study. After all, they're all master's students. They are uninformed, unmotivated on their actual objective. Every research begins with a quest. I would like to remind all prospective researchers here, every research begins with a quest. In literature research, I have seen prospective researchers accost mentors, approach mentors with virtually no clue to their research objective, or even sometimes blank slate. My talk today shall not cover the story from the beginning, which I hope has already been covered by previous speakers, as I have been informally by Dr. Shamata, that around two lectures on the hypothesis, the development of a research question, etc. I guess these topics have been covered by previous speakers. Besides, I also have been very diligently taken cognizance of an advice, a friendly advice, a request made by Professor Ghanshyam a few days ago, requesting me to touch upon the notion of emotional intelligence in research. And I have tried to live up to his expectations. So here is my topic, the anxiety of influence in literary research towards new methodologies of affect. Now, let me just start with a question posed by J. Hillis Miller on Literature, published in 2002. He says that, in fact, it's a very cautionary statement. It's not a question, but a cautionary statement. The end of literature is at hand. Literature's time is almost up. In fact, the question now is, what has been going on in our universities? Now, in the last two decades, and even before that, the discipline of literature or literary studies, literary research, have been clogged up by fashionable turns advanced by critical theory, quote unquote critical theory. Each fashionable bend in, just as you have a bend in a river, rivers meander through its bends. Similarly, the river of literary theory has gone through several fashionable bends. And each such fashionable bend in literary research was propped up by vantage points like post-humanism, a sort of a maelstrom of influences. And this is what I have defined as or labeled as the estuary of critical theory, with fashionable labels like post-humanism, identity, alterity, etc. Questions on sexuality, gender, which seem to reiterate a postmodernism, semiotics, which seem to reiterate the same crisis in humanism with more and more meta-narratives, each meta-narrative challenging and advancing the other, promoting the other. Interventions of politics, race, gender, ethnicity, border studies, divisions, human divisions, human mobility, hatred, trauma, and whatnot. Each meta-narrative relished its own credulity and challenged the other's incredulity. If I may be allowed to quote from one of Lyotard's phrase, where he speaks about the incredulity of meta-narratives as a marked feature of the postmodern condition today. That, we are living in an age of meta-narratives, and each meta-narrative has an incredulity about it. So each such theoretical stance is a meta-narrative on its own right, and each meta-narrative both relishes as well as rubbishes the other's credulity. So this is what I can call this the incredulity of the meta-narrative of theory. Now, even to advance from what I just now stated, we can also see how our researchers, our students, are being narcotically drawn towards critical theory. Please read my quote here. I would like to read out to you as well. One of the strongest symptoms of the imminent death of literature, I'm quoting from the critic I already mentioned, J. Hillis Miller. One of the strongest symptoms of the imminent death of literature is the way younger faculty members in departments of literature all over the world are turning in droves from literary study to theory, cultural studies, etc. At all, you know. And it is interesting to observe that some vantage points, some critical frameworks survive the test of time, and some fade out. So, you know, the question is there some sort of a Darwinian natural selection which determines the survival of some ideas and the extinction and the death of other vantage points? That is my question. So my proposal would be to let us, as academicians, as students, we are all students of literature primarily. Before we are teachers of literature, we are all students of literature. So as students of literature, as practitioners of criticism, let us set our house in order first. And let us propose, seek more sustainable and more strong, sustainable vantage points of research, vantage points of analysis, which may orient us towards a very constructive epistemic direction. And it is to be noted here that our academia, as I mentioned earlier too, that our academia has become clogged. The oikos of our academia, oikos, the Greek word from which the word ecology has evolved, which means home, which means, the space which we call home. And if we take academia to be our oikos has been literally clogged by a certain dormitive principle. And, critical theory is that dormitive principle. And we are looking forward to proposing, in fact, all of us, inward, within ourselves, we know that we need to bring about radical changes in this oikos of critical theory. Now, why do we need a methodology at all? What is methodology? Because my talk is primarily to do with methodology, research methodology. Why do we need a methodology at research methodology as it is applicable to literature studies? And please note that the way the word methodology is used in the social sciences is not the way in which we use the word methodology in literature studies, in literary research, okay? In fact, what they call methodology, we call method rather. Like say, for example, if we go for a sort of a survey, if we go for an interview, if we choose a specific tool, like say, the biographical mode or the ethnographic mode, these are all methods, not methodology, as the social scientists would like to call this activity. So when we talk about methodology in literature studies, we are actually referring to a theoretical framework which follows a statement of purpose, the objective. I'm sure students by now are familiar with what is meant by a statement of purpose. All literary research begins with a quest, as is evident in this slide of mine. It begins with a quest, a statement of expectation or prediction, which ought to be followed by a few tests in order to examine or explore the veracity of the quest, whether, you know, the path that you've taken, the statement of expectation that you've raised, whether that can be carried forward or not, whether that would reach its desired telos or not, end or not. That is something which needs to be explored. So,
sir, lights are not visible.
Is it?
Yes.
I haven't yet switched my slide. I'm still in this slide. I'm talking right now. I haven't proceeded to my next slide. I'm discussing this slide. So we need, when we present a statement of expectation, it is expected that we need to follow up that statement of expectation with a few tests in order to examine or explore the veracity of that statement of expectation. The statement of expectation is also popularly known as the objective of research, or the research question, or the research statement. So ultimately it is this research statement or the statement of expectation which becomes the hypothesis. Let me give you an example. I'm going very slow. I will not switch over from one slide to the other at a fast pace. I'm going to discuss each slide. Let me give you an example. How does a statement of expectation lead to a title? How does a statement of expectation lead to a title? And then from the title onwards, it would move to an elaboration of the statement of expectation, and then a sort of a methodology would be sought. But before that, let me give you a sample. This is an example from not literature, but from, say, the social sciences. If I make a statement like this, listen to the statement carefully. The recognition of the right to physician-assisted suicide. Please note carefully. I'm making a statement right now, and I'm not discussing literature. The recognition of the right to physician-assisted suicide is a protection of individual civil liberties. I'm talking about euthanasia. If I make this statement that the recognition of the right to physician-assisted suicide or euthanasia is a protection of individual civil liberties. Now, this is a statement that I'm making. This can be a research hypothesis, or a statement of purpose, or a statement of expectation. Or this can also be a research question, like whether the recognition of the right to physician-assisted suicide is actually a protection of individual civil liberties. Now, it is from this statement of expectation that a title may emerge, like the right to physician-assisted suicide and individual civil liberties, : a study, a sociological study. This is exactly how, you know, a statement of expectation generates a hypothesis, which, ultimately results in a title formulation, obviously assisted by the mentor or the supervisor. Now, it has been found that in almost all cases, the next part of my slide, in almost all cases, the hypothesis or the statement of expectation requires that the researcher be familiar with at least one or more disciplines besides one's own discipline. Like, we are students of literature. When we generate a research statement, when we make a research statement, when we formulate a hypothesis, the researcher must be familiar with at least one or two more disciplines besides literature to aid his or her study. Disciplines which may provide theoretical stilts or supports to the statement of expectation or hypothesis. Now, these theoretical stilts are what collectively may be referred to as methodology. In other words, theoretical stills, theoretical framework, which will assist the researcher in proving the veracity of the research statement, to maintaining or to, you know, sort of fulfilling the quest. That is exactly what we mean by a hypothesis. Now, let me cite an example from literature. Here is my next slide. Here is a research statement. Here is a statement of purpose. Harriet Beecher.
Sorry to tell you, your slide is not visible, sir.
Is this slide not visible?
No. Yes, sir.
Can you see the slide? Harriet Beecher Stowe's novel. Is it visible?
No, sir.
No, sir. I think you have not shared, sir.
Sir, good afternoon, but you have not shared it since the beginning itself, sir.
Is it? I have been... Okay, then I'll check up.
But you continue, please. You're speaking so well. It will deviate, sir. I'm Dr. Pratibha Kumar from Government Mahakaushal Arts and Commerce College.
No, I'm just... Give me a minute. I'll just check up, you know, what's... If anything is wrong with my sharing, I'll just... check up,
please.
Because it's uncomfortable, because I've been speaking all through and I suddenly realized that
actually Professor Ghanshyam told you in the beginning itself, but then you were at a...
I have shared after Professor Ghanshyam told me in fact I shared. I don't know what's gone wrong,
but sir, you can continue without the slide.
I think please. Because there are certain things which I have to show you.
Okay.
So thank you. Patriot, can you assist me?
Sir, if you see, it's you can go to stop sharing, and once again you can reshare.
Yes, okay. Sir. That's it.
Okay. Yeah, I got it now. Okay. Is it shared now?
Sir, yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, now, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. We can see now.
You can see it now.
You can. Oh, you
I
can
think maximum. I had yeah. You know, stopped my video once. That I think has you know.
Sir, you please maximize it.
Yeah. Now it's visible, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Yeah. Visible.
Okay. So if you haven't seen my earlier slides, let me just take you through them. So, you know, this was my title. I've been speaking about the anxiety of influence in literary research towards new methodologies of affect. And we've been discussing what has been going on in our universities and, you know, how our academia has been clogged up, you know, by theoretical turns through the entire 20th century and still, you know, clogged up. And how students and researchers are narcotically addicted to critical theory sometimes at the cost of, you know, the literary text. And this has become a sort of a anxiety for the teacher, for the, you know, for the mentor as well. So my objective was to, you know, just to set our house in order and try to find out an alternative, whether, you know, we can propose a sort of a new methodology at all. And here, my last slide, I was discussing what we mean by a methodology. And in this context, let me come to my, example, my second example from literature. I hope my slide is visible now.
Yes, sir. Yes. Could you please choose the option slideshow, then the whole slide would be clearly visible.
Okay.
You can go at the bottom. There is a cup kind of a thing, or else you can go to the slideshow on the top. Yeah, if you come down to the bottom where the volume button is there, just by the side, yes, of that, if you click that, yeah, just the volume button, your cursor can go down.
Left.
On the right side.
A cup shape icon is there towards the right hand side corner.
If you click that, sir, the slides will be all maximized.
Sir, no, or you could go on the slideshow. That would be more easier. Right. Because...
Yeah, that's slideshow. Yeah, sure, it's visible.
Now it's very effective.
Yes.
Sir, we can't hear you. I think you've put it on mute, sir.
Is it okay now? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, fine. Well, this is a classic example of a research statement for those students pursuing research in English studies or literature studies. A statement of purpose. I provided you with an example of a statement of purpose from the discipline of social sciences. And now this here is a statement of purpose from the discipline of literature. Harriet Beecher Stowe's novel, Uncle Tom's Cabin, influenced changes in the law of slavery before and after the Civil War in America. Now, in other words, Uncle Tom's Cabin helped lay the groundwork for the Civil War. And if this is a research statement, it is inevitable that the disciplines which ought to be perused by the student, by the researcher, ought to range from history of America, history of slavery, bonded labor, political history of America, etc. Now, these are disciplines which are not core to literature, but disciplines in order to proceed with the research. Now, this is exactly what we call research methodology. If you can follow me. Now, it is from this hypothesis, from that research statement, Harriet Beecher Stowe's novel, Uncle Tom's Cabin, influenced changes in the law of slavery before and after the Civil War in America. It is from this research statement that we can have a prospective tentative title, Fiction and Social Change, a reading of Harriet Beecher Stowe's Uncle Tom's Cabin. This can be a prospective research title. Obviously, this will be an MPhil title at the most. It will not, obviously, the corpus wouldn't be as large to accommodate a PhD thesis. However, this is a tentative title which may emerge from a hypothesis, from a statement of purpose. So I guess, and in order to carry forward this study, it is inevitable that the student has to take into account certain disciplines which are, beyond the immediate scope of literature. Here comes the relevance of methodology. Here comes the need of methodology, the theoretical background. Now, the anxiety influence in research methodology, in the area of research methodology. When we choose a methodology, what is the anxiety? We are all, students are affected by a sort of an anxiety. What happens to the student? How researchers, even before venturing into a study, will automatically be affected by, even before venturing into and identifying or defining a corpus, as I provided in this slide, before defining a corpus, before even formulating a broad statement of purpose, displays a general tendency to gravitate towards one or more theoretical vantage points that are in fashion. Now, please remember, my dear students and prospective researchers, your reading must dictate a methodology. Please do not be dictated upon by methodology. Reading must dictate a methodology, not vice versa. And I spoke about charting out a constructive, and a sustainable epistemic direction. A work of literature, please remember that you are students of literature above all. Okay? We are students of literature above all. And, you know, a work of literature is here to stay. Braving the test of time. Have you ever wondered why a work of literature is here to stay? What makes a work of literature survive the test of time? The cliched answer would be that, you know, literature has a universal appeal. But why and how? How and why does literature have a universal appeal? The answer lies in our roots. Yes, our own roots, our very Indian roots. But often, in fact, I'm not going to talk about this right now, but often, in fact, we, you know, need a third party sometimes to familiarize us with our own roots. And let us first understand what that third party has to say. I will go back to a discussion on our roots later. But as I told you just now, that sometimes, you know, in order to familiarize ourselves, in order to recognize our roots, we need a third party. Unfortunately, but then we sometimes need a third party. So let us try to find out what that third party has to say. I'd like to refer prospective researchers to, a very famous, in fact, you know, two very famous philosophers, theorists, contemporary theorists, Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari, who in their book, I was talking about third party here, you know, the third party is the duo, Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari, who in their book, A Thousand Plateaus, states, and I quote Gilles Deleuze, literature is a container of affective encounters. Literature is a container of affective encounters. Look at my slide here. We are actually going back to aesthetics. We are actually going back to, you know, our emphasis on perception as opposed to material perspectives. So let's get back to what Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari state in their book, A Thousand Plateaus. They say that literature is a container of affective encounters through which reciprocity is activated. What does literature ultimately deal with? What does art ultimately deal with? Literature ultimately deals with bodies, subjects. And we know nothing about a body until we know what affects are. Here is my emphasis on the notion of affect. We do not know, we would not know much about a body, a subject, until and unless we know what affects are, how they engage, how one affect engages with other affects. By affects, I mean emotional states. How one emotional response, rather. You know, conditions and influences other affects of another body. Aesthetics, as we all know, is all about the art of cognition, of perceptions, and sometimes a chain of perceptions. Sense perception is essential to human knowledge. And, you know, all perceptions are interlinked with each other. So it is from here that we perhaps may proceed to towards a very constructive and a sustaining epistemic direction, which may provide us with new insights on what come in future. Now, I slightly digress. Of late, we were talking about perceptions. In my last slide, I was talking about perceptions. Of late, our perceptions have all been, and are quite degeneratively so, all our perceptions have been annulled, or rather becoming annulled, doped under the impact of a gangrene which has set in. You know, a gangrene has set in today, alienating us from our own perceptions. We are talking about perceptions, but do we know how to perceive? Do we know how to perceive? In fact, aren't we losing our own perceptive skills? In fact, perception is something which is very innate to us. But you know, today we are talking about understanding perceptive skills, as if, you know, we need to culture and nurture skills to, you know, to introduce ourselves to our own affects. And why has this happened? Because, you know, right now, today, we are under the impact of a gangrene, which has alienated us from our perceptions. And this is what you know, Gregory Bateson calls the gangrene of mass media. The gangrene of mass media is spreading so rapidly and has assumed such toxic, virulent, and contagious proportions today in the midst of intense techno-scientific transformations that, you know, we are totally helpless. Virulent and contagious, I have used these two very, very strong words. Virulent and contagious. I can see some hands raised. We'll come back to the questions later on. Gangrene of mass media has become extremely virulent and toxic. I use these two words because it has begun to affect human modes of life in a way which is becoming uncontrollable. Our perceptions have become doped. You know, we are under sort of a dope. We have begun to experience a disconnect of sorts within our own kinships, human to human kinship, human to nature kinship, as if, you know, we are on weeds. We are on weed under the influence of ganja. Gregory Bateson, you know, would have called this, that, you know, he calls this the ecology of weeds. We will come back to Gregory Bateson a little later. Every relationship today, family relationships, conjugal relationships, are frequently being ossified by a sort of standardization of behavior. Social media, digital media has literally reprogrammed us in a manner that it has become a sort of a narcotic weed, without sniffing which we are unable to breathe. Félix Guattari and Gilles Deleuze, in fact, Félix Guattari in particular, in his book, The Three Ecologies, calls this gangrene of mass media the new social ecology of the era of techno-capitalism. In fact, we cannot survive without techno-capitalism. You know, techno-capitalism has made life easier. We are very much obsessed with this idea of ease of living today. You know, we are creating indexes which are trying to find out which of the following cities in India have the best ease of living according to a certain index. So, you know, these sort of the gifts or the goals of this techno-capitalism are seemingly very, very non-capitalist, because, you know, everything is affordable. Social media is highly affordable. And it has almost brought about a sort of a miniaturization of, you know, social space. And not only that, if you observe the last point of the slide, collective mass media subjectivities. Social media has created such a situation in which we have begun to be affected by mass media subjectivities. How we mold our subjectivities as per, you know, Instagram and Facebook profiles. It is becoming a sort of a fetish. It has begun to dictate our lives. This is exactly what Gregory Bateson, in his book Steps to an Ecology of the Mind, published in 1972, he calls this the ecology of bad ideas. He says there is an ecology of bad ideas just as there is an ecology of weeds. Now, why am I referring to all this? I'm referring to all this is that the reason why I'm referring to all this, to the ecology of weeds, I'm referring to the gangrene of mass media, because, you know, it is important for us to understand that we have to go back to our own perceptions once again. We have to rekindle, reactivate our perceptive orientations in, as students of literature, in the reading of texts. How do we read texts today? Not just literary texts, mind you. When I'm referring to the word texts, I'm not just referring to literary works. I'm talking about any text for that matter. In fact, even an advertisement, a commercial, which is always visible, on your television screens, on your pop-ups, they are also texts. So, you know, how to intercept our affects, how the interception of affects can enable us to read texts from a new vantage point. So to read texts first as a container of affective encounters through which reciprocity is activated. Okay, and this is how we may adopt what Gregory Bateson and even Felix Guattari calls an ecosophical approach, not ecocritical, mind you, an ecosophical approach, which accommodates all our material and our biological entity. It accommodates our social and cultural, habitats, and it also encompasses our perceptual life, how human subjectivity may be articulated, expressed through images, sounds, and hapticity, by our tactile sensory perceptions. So literature is a container of affects. That is exactly how we look at it. Now, let me show you a video. You see, I told you that I am not just dealing with literary texts. Let's take the example of this very short commercial. I don't know if I'm boring you or not, but just for a sort of a breather, I will provide you with yes.
Very interesting.
Okay, thank you. Let me just provide you with a sneak preview of a very, very short video on, I titled this slide, Polar Bear in the Zoo. Have a look at this commercial and see for yourself. We'll discuss this.
ये पोलर बेयर कई दिनों से उदास है इसकी वजह शायद बर्फ जैसी सफेदी होने की कमी है क्या कुछ ऐसा है जो इस पोलर बेयर को खुश कर सकता है
है ना बिल्ला व्हाइट कॉल के पुट्टी क्योंकि ये है बर्फ से भी सफेद
ये तो कमाल हो गया बिरला व्हाइट वॉल पे पुट्टी की सफेदी से पोलर बेयर इतना खुश
बिरला व्हाइट वॉल के पुट्टी में है बेहतरीन क्वालिटी वाला बिरला व्हाइट सीमेंट जो दे सबसे ज्यादा सफेदी इसलिए चुनिए जर्मन टेक्नोलॉजी से बने पॉलीमर्स वाली बिरला व्हाइट वॉल के पुट्टी यही है एशिया की असली और सबसे सफेद पुट्टी
A little while ago, I was talking about our grand disconnect. I'm sure you must have recognized how disconnected we have become. How we have literally snapped off that umbilical cord, connecting us with nature. And you know, in how insensitive this advertisement is. Now, you know, if we go for a sort of a critiquing of a text, and if we take this particular commercial as a text, okay, remember, we may go back to our own perceptive skills to offer a sort of a critiquing of this sort of a, you know, extremely and aggressively anthropocentric, you know, approach to life, to culture, extremely aggressive anthropocentric attitude to life, to culture, to materialism, that we have simply forgotten about the fact that, you know, there is virtually no difference between us and, you know, that bear, because we are all, you know, part and parcel of the universal principle that is life. We are all part and parcel of the cosmos. So there has been a sort of a cosmic, you know, dissonance, which, you know, perhaps late capitalism has initiated. And, you know, and our obsession with, you know, materiality perhaps has complicated the matter further. And we really don't know where the end lies. Now, if we start looking at this as a problem, then, you know, I would say that we are proceeding towards an ecosophical approach, you know, to life, to art, to culture. So here is a sort of a new methodology which may emerge, which is deeply affect-centric. I will again, I'll proceed from here. A definition of art. How can we define art today? And I'm sure all my students and prospective researchers and my colleagues will agree with me that art is actually a refrain or a ritornello of sorts. What is a ritornello? Ritornello, you know, it's an Italian word. Again, I'm quoting from Deleuze and Guattari, A Thousand Plateaus. Now, let me explain to you in brief, in a very simple, and read the slide as I speak. Ritornello is a very short instrumental refrain or an interlude in a vocal work, in a musical composition. And the word ritornello, if translated into, you know, English, simple English, would just mean return, return. Can anybody disagree with me here that art evokes nostalgia? A poem may evoke nostalgia, a song may evoke nostalgia, a cinema may evoke nostalgia. Art evokes nostalgia and facilitates a sort of a return to territories inhabited and lived before. All art does that. All good art has the power to do it, evoking nostalgia and facilitating a return to territories inhabited and lived before. This is what is meant by ritornello effect. I'm sure those of you who are are into music would also cinema, in fact, background music. You will find that in cinema, sometimes specific background music, specific background strains are used to, you know, evoke specific emotions pertaining to specific territories. Like when the protagonist is coming back home after a long time, a certain, you know, refrain is played upon as a background music. Background music, you know, sometimes provides a lot of sort of energy and vitality to our own affects in the theater, in cinema, and they enkindle a lot of responses. Now, this is what is understood in the domain of music as the ritornello effect. Deleuze and Guattari, they rather import this ritornello effect from the domain of music to the domain of all art, for that matter. All art, can exert a ritornello effect of sorts. Art creates nostalgia and facilitates a return to spaces, to territories inhabited and lived before. They may be spaces, they may be situations, they may be moments. I'm, very tempted to, quote, in fact, a very famous, some very famous lines from a very popular Gulzar lyric, from the film Golmaal. Ek baar waqt se lamha gira kahi, waha dasta mili lamha kahi nahi. So I'm sure you know that song. I'm talking about aane wala pal jaane wala hai. Now, you see, please observe the lines there, Gulzarji's, magic. Ek baar waqt se lamha gira kahi, waha dasta mili lamha kahi nahi. A poem, a story, a slice of action in theater, cinema, sometimes acts like a symphonic passage, which returns again and again in a musical composition, through which the recipient subject or the relisher, the spectator or the listener, is ritornellized. I'm using the word ritornellized. So in art, in the realm of art, when you read a poem or a story, or when you watch a slice of action in theater or cinema, sometimes these passages act like symphonic passages in music, in musical compositions, through which the spectator or the listener or the recipient subject is ritornalized, or rather is caught up in a sort of a web of emotions, leading to the formation of a sort of an existential territory for the time being at least. Okay, and I'm quoting from Nicolas Bouriard in his very famous book. If you're interested, you can please read this book, Relational Aesthetics, where Bouriard says, art fixes energy and ritualizes it, diverting it from everyday life. Art is the thing upon which and round which subjectivity can reform itself, the way several light spots are brought together to form a beam and light up a single point. It's a very beautiful observation by Nicolas Bouriard. Now, let me come back to what I was saying. I was telling you that all this while, I was telling you that sometimes we need a third party to, familiarize us with our roots. Now, all that I've said right now, whether, Deleuze and Guattari's concept of ritornello, or, Gregory Bateson, all of these works, to some extent, remind us of our roots. I was talking about the ritornello effect just a while ago. Let me remind you that Deleuze and Guattari, and sometimes third parties like Deleuze and Guattari, offer a sort of a ritornello reminding us of our roots, because all of them have been indebted directly or indirectly to Indian aesthetics, ancient Indian aesthetics. How a literary work may trigger reciprocity through affective encounters was for the first time introduced long before the West had ever woken up. It is all there in Bharat Muni's Natyashastra. Everything is there in Bharat Muni's Natyashastra. How art is a container of affects. How a literary work may trigger reciprocity through affective encounters. And not only that, much later, much before Deleuze and Guattari, Spinoza in the 17th century, late 17th century, mid 17th century, in his Ethics. If you read Spinoza's Ethics, particularly part 4 of that work, I've mentioned that in my slide of human bondage or the power of affects, where, you know, Spinoza talks about how every changing relations between subjects and their bodily forces, okay, encounter between, you know, bodies and their so-called, you know, perceptive encounters. This is the basis of ethics, according to Spinoza. So Spinoza, when in fact, in this chapter, in part four of ethics, you know, he lists more than 48 affects. And when he lists them, they almost echo Bharat Muni's Natyashastra, where, you know, there are mention of the 8 sthayi bhavas and 33 vyabhichari bhavas. You'll almost feel, you know, as if you'll be tempted to, when you're reading Spinoza's, ethics, you'll be tempted to go back to the Natyashastra. I mean, how can there be? This is too much of a coincidence. This is too much of a coincidence. I really don't know if you've, if you've read Spinoza's ethics or not. Please read this chapter, this part of the work of human bondage or the power of affects. Again, let me go back to that third party once again, Delusion Gattari, 1,000 Plateaus, a very, very interesting quote. You know, in fact, they say, we know nothing about a body until we know what it can do to, in other words, what its affects are. How they can or cannot enter into composition with other affects, with the affects of another body, either to destroy that body or to be destroyed by, either to exchange action and passions with it or to join with it in composing a more powerful body. Now, Delusion Gattari in their 1,000 Plateaus, they are indebted to Spinoza's ethics. Okay, but what I'm actually trying to get at is, you know, all this is a sort of a returnal of sorts, leading us back to where we began. So, you know, perhaps this affective turn which we are finding in contemporary, you know, literary research, in contemporary theory, you know, contemporary theory is actually going through another bend. I'm talking about Western theory, is going through another bend. And this final bend, this, you know, present bend that we are, you know, negotiating, is a bend which eerily rather, you know, echoes our own roots at some point of time. Let us try to find out what happens in an affective encounter when we are reading a text. Let us proceed with an example. How may a student or a researcher wean himself or herself? I'm using the word weaning, W-E-A-N-I-N-G. How may a researcher today wean herself or himself out of the lure of critical theory via all the disciplines that lie outside of the territory of literature? Researchers remember that literature is our territory. Our territory is not social sciences. Our territory is not, you know, politics. Our territory is not history. Yes, we cannot proceed without referring to, you know, our matrix. We will definitely talk about history. We need to talk about, our borders. We need to talk about our identities. They provide us with our locus. We cannot, detach ourselves from our locus. But as students of literature, we can detach ourselves from the lure of critical theory at the cost of the study of literature. So researchers, remember that literature is our territory. We need to situate ourselves there first. A text suddenly comes to my mind in this regard when I'm talking about all this. It suddenly comes to my mind. In fact, let us, before moving over to that text, let us take the example of one of the most powerful affects. You'll find that in my slide. One of the most powerful affects which control us sometimes, which overpowers us sometimes, disgust. The world is actually becoming disgusting. It's, you know, life is becoming disgusting for us in many ways, in more ways than one. So disgust is one of the most powerful dominating affects that we are all influenced by today, which, you know, disgust, which was in Bharat Muni's Natya Shastra, the sthayi bhava is jugupsa. Now, during my slides, I was suddenly reminded of a particular work which I generally teach in class, Franz Fanon's Black Skin, White Masks. I'm sure all of you are familiar with this work. You know, it's a classic study of, race, using the methodology of psychoanalysis. I'm sure the methodological support which a prospective researcher may seek when one is confronted with a text which has certain resonances of race will obviously be seduced by Franz Fanon, would obviously be seduced by theories of race, will be seduced by semiotics, semiology, Freudian and Kleinian psychoanalysis, etc., theories of introjection, projection, etc. So how would a scholar in English studies with the baggage of modern critical theory read Franz Fanon's autobiographical study of racial encounters in Martinique? Can we seek an alternative methodological study? Can we seek an alternative methodology? How would an alternative methodology deal with the anxiety of influence of, you know, Franz Fanon, of semiotics, of Freudian and Kleinian psychoanalysis, etc.? How would, an alternative methodology be developed? What are some of the convention theoretical vantage points when one is reading Fanon, or when one is reading, say, Toni Morrison's The Bluest Eye, would definitely, go back to, conventional postcolonial texts or theoretical vantage points. Let us go back to Fanon once again and try to study from a particular excerpt from Fanon's Black Skin, White Masks. And how we can propose a new alternative methodology of reading Fanon. Fanon recounts, as you know, a sort of a racial encounter between a black-skinned Martinican with a white European child, where, you know, on the streets, this white-skinned child suddenly is traumatized when he sees a Negro child, and he tells his mama, "Look, mama, a Negro, I'm frightened." Now, Franz Fanon is witness to this encounter. And Franz Fanon compares the experience of to that of a fictional consciousness of an insect captured as the laboratory specimen. And Franz Fanon, you know, this white child is referring to that dark-skinned child as, you know, "Look, mama, Negro, I'm frightened." Franz Fanon says that I am affected by it. And it seems I progress by crawling, and slowly I am being dissected under white eyes, the only real eyes. He feels that he has been reduced to a sort of a laboratory specimen, like an insect in the laboratory being dissected under white eyes, the only real eyes. Now, remember again, once again, for students of literature, you are a literature student. And say you are going through Franz Fanon's Black Skin, White Masks, and you are, this is not a literary work as such, but anyway, as a student of literature, how would you interpret this? And before doing that, I would like to caution my students that, you know, theory must be once again adopted with caution. avoid the motto theory for theory's sake. Your work must naturally invite a methodological framework and not be carried away by its currents. Okay, so let us try to find out alternative frameworks. An affect-based reading. How would I choose, how would I go through a sort of an affect-based reading of, say, any literary work or any film, for that matter, dealing with race or racial encounters? First of all, we can go back to Spinoza. This is just a sort of a proposition. I'm providing you with a sort of a tool. We can go back to Spinoza. Spinoza's distinction between affectio and affectus, both refer to emotions. Affectio and affectus both mean emotions. You know, and we may study how affect has both virtual and actual expressions. What actually happens in an affective encounter when one body is involved with another body? Like in this case, the white child being involved, interacting with a dark-skinned child. What actually happens in an affective encounter? A virtual expression of that encounter is assimilated by the speaker or spectator, independent of the participants themselves in fiction. So as a reader of fiction, when we are reading, we are actually a sort of going through a sort of a virtual encounter. Franz Fanon chooses the psychoanalytic route to understand race, you know, with a dash of semiotics. But you as a reader may choose the affective route to avoid a sort of a reductive, detached, and objective tool of analysis. And let me move over to some of my final slides. You know, Gregory Bateson, once again, going back to Gregory Bateson, he was an ecosopher, we can call him an ecosopher, observed how the arts, how literature and literary works or all aesthetic works practice ecological thought, because they promote and sustain shifts in awareness, perspective, and generate new connections. In other words, Gregory Bateson uses, you know, the word care as the key to ecosophy. By transforming embodied minds, art's ability, you know, art has the magical ability to heal, to act as a sort of a reconstructive biopower. And if the researcher, you know, using the root of roots provided by Giles, Deleuze, and Guattari, and then, you know, Spinoza, definitely they are third parties. Okay, but, you know, we can't help but refer to them, because they provide a sort of a very sustained and a very structured sort of a, you know, a base. So the job of the reader is to reconceive expressivity as a dynamic, transformative movement, so that thinking, acting, and caring can function as a whole. So, you know, when we are reading a work on racism, or when we are watching a film on racial hatred or ethnic violence, the word heal or the word care perhaps can be more appealing in this age of, you know, crisis in literary studies. And sometimes perhaps the route of the route through or rather via the affects, understanding affects, exploring the affects. Like if we discuss the encounter between the white child and the black child through an exploration of affects, perhaps we would land up with you know, a far more enriching sort of a methodological framework, which perhaps, if not anything, it would aspire towards becoming a sort of an agency of care or healing. I'm sure you remember the very famous short story by O. Henry, The Last Leaf. Now, the vocabulary of high theory with its claustrophobia may thus be diffused through affect-based reading of literature. In other words, race can be negotiated through study of affects. One of the most powerful affects is disgust, as I just now provided you, I just now mentioned in an earlier slide. So how can we, use care? What is care? Through care's intersubjective and transpersonal connectivity, one may analyze how disgust is shaped, developed, and hence embodied. We need to understand how disgust is born in the mind, how disgust is shaped in the mind, how disgust is developed in the mind, and hence how disgust is embodied in the mind. So in order to understand hatred, we need to know how hatred has been embodied. Without understanding hatred, we cannot diffuse hatred. So care can be the only means by which humans and nature materially transcend their own boundaries to generate expressivity beyond language. So caregiving processes carried out in art and art criticism, with all its tactility, hapticity, etc., negotiates both nearness and distances as a form of healing. And hence, new strategies of reading may be promoted, new material connections may be discovered in the process. So, that is how I would like to, come to the end of my talk. In other words, Guattari's search for a new aesthetic paradigm. We are actually trying to find out, search for a new aesthetic paradigm. And this may be drawn upon in the context of which artistic practices may be assessed. So this could literally break open high theory's stranglehold on literature studies. High theory has maintained its stranglehold on literature studies for, decades together. So by adopting this alternative paradigm, we may create a sort of a climate which may inspire a more lucid interpretation of literary texts. So you see, this baggage of literary theory, this baggage of high critical theory, is something which is a sort of an albatross which we have been carrying on our shoulders, and perhaps the time has come when the albatross needs to be shed off. Hence, I thought of providing you with a quotation from Coleridge's The Rime of the Ancient Mariner. The self-same moment I could pray, and from my neck so free the albatross fell off and sank like lead into the sea. So we are all waiting for that moment when, our academia would shed its albatross. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. It has been really enlightening, very insightful, and the comments of our participants does abounds the fact that it has been a truly informative and very interesting indeed. Thank you, sir, for beautifully explaining each step of literary research that a student of research has to encounter. Indeed, you have raised several bends in literary research. And as you had said, every student is affected by an anxiety while taking any topic of research. And therefore, if there are researchers who are listening to your talk today, I'm definitely sure that your talk must have truly enlightened them. Now, I would also like to request our participants to to put forward their questions or queries, which our resource person would be delighted to answer.
Hello.
Can't hear you. I think there's a network problem there somewhere out there.
Once again, I would like to, there is a question from one of our participants. Mr. Sudhakar Shakya raises this question, how to decide a proper research methodology? Sir?
Yes, Mr. Sudhakar Shakya, this is something, this is a very, you know, a very basic question and something which every researcher needs to take into account. I think methodology comes at a later stage. One mustn't worry too much about methodology at the beginning of, at the entry point. The methodology would automatically emerge from the research question, which I very categorically mentioned in my earlier part, in the first part of my lecture. The methodology must not dictate the research. The research question must naturally lead to the methodology. Okay, and to do this, I'm sure your mentor or your supervisor.
May I also rephrase sir's earlier talk, which says that one's reading must dictate the methodology to be undertaken for the research. Yes.
Ma'am, can I ask the question now?
Yes, yeah, please,
sure, please. Okay. Sir, as I had told you, I'm Dr. Pratibha Kumar from Government Mahakaushal Arts and Commerce Lead College, Jabalpur. I'm heading the Department of English. A very fruitful and a very, very knowledgeable session indeed. Throughout your lecture, I was trying to recollect the lines of Wordsworth's definition of poetry, where he says it is a spontaneous overflow of emotions, recollected in tranquility. I could make a phrase for my own for your lecture is, it was a spontaneous overflow of knowledge that you have in you. Thank you so much, sir, for a thought-provoking session.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Sir, it is not my question, actually. It is my query that generally my research scholars get confused about making, before entering or deciding into a title of their own of a proper research work. They generally are confused with the hypothesis, hypothesis in a research work and a hypothesis in a research work just for a paper writing, okay? Mm. And the hypothesis for a project. Mm. So my query is, can you enlighten us on this point? What are the differences of hypothesis in for a research paper and hypothesis for a PhD thesis and hypothesis for a project work?
Thank you, ma'am, for your question. Let me answer the first part of your question. The difference between a hypothesis of a research paper and the hypothesis of a thesis. Now, we must not forget that a thesis is a sort of a journey which has not yet begun. Like, say, for example, let me give you a simple example from our own daily lives. When we are all travelers, we all love traveling. When we want to travel to a place which we have not seen, like, say, for example, I have never been to Kashmir. I would like to go to Kashmir. So if I am planning to go to Kashmir, I will definitely have a roadmap on my table.
Sure.
Okay. And that roadmap will chart out a sort of a course, a journey, the course of my journey.
And, I hope I hope my research scholars are listening because they've joined your lecture.
Okay. Actually, it's meant primarily for them.
Yeah.
Meant primarily for them.
Question for them only, actually. So.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. Because this is something which all students,
should
face.
Yeah.
So when we are planning out on a trip to Kashmir, say, for example, I'm planning out a trip on Kashmir, I need to have a roadmap before me. Whether you would admit it or not, all of us, nobody would say that, well, I just, set out without a sort of a roadmap, without an end in view. We all have an end in view and we all have a roadmap.
Yes.
But in the course of our journey, when we actually undertake the journey, we plan from, say, of journey. Mm-hmm. Now, when we actually are on that trip, we may make changes. We end up making so many changes. In fact, we end up making more changes than we had ever imagined.
Yes.
Okay. Now, therefore, a thesis is a long-term project. Okay. It may take 4 years, 5 years, sometimes even more. So, one does not know what is going to happen, how one's study or where one's explorations may lead the researcher. The researcher himself or herself does not know where one is headed toward. In that case, nevertheless, we always need a roadmap. Without a roadmap, we cannot proceed. So hypothesis for a thesis is almost like that roadmap. It's like a plan of action, which is very clearly articulated, which has to be very clearly articulated. Like something like, we have a sort of a minute-to-minute program schedule. It's not as precise as that, but as a sort of a point-to-point sort of
You mean say that there should be a proper outline of your chapters and that you shouldn't be deviating from your point
One must remember, all students must remember that the hypothesis is to be tested. Okay, hypothesis is to be tested in the course of the study. It may well happen that what you propose in your hypothesis may not exactly turn out to be the way you had envisioned.
Yes.
Which is why when you are formulating the title, one must be extremely careful. The title must be, so constructed that it should leave room for maneuver.
It should be
slightly accommodating. It should not be restrictive or confined. Okay, it should open up certain ventilators, which will allow the researcher to make necessary maneuvers.
Yes, true.
Okay.
And now, what about the project type or hypothesis?
In the case of the paper, obviously a paper is a very, very, it has a limited scope. So in the paper, the research, the hypothesis must be extremely well articulated and absolutely clear. There should be clarity there. I'm not saying that the research hypothesis should not have clarity. It definitely has to have clarity, but temporary clarity. There's a temporal element in the hypothesis of a research. And as far as project is concerned, A project is, I think, far more open, because a project is can only be realized in action. Okay, a project can only be realized in action. Hence, the project hypothesis can be more of a sort of a a roadmap. It's also a sort of a roadmap, but a roadmap which is to be assessed and enacted in praxis.
Okay,
because a project obviously is a project. A project is an activity based sort of a study, in whatever way. Even if it is a project which is carried out by students of the Department of English, that too would require some kind of an activity based and that also has an immediacy about it.
Yes, true.
So
yes, I think
I was able to exactly satisfy your query.
Partially yes, sir, but yes, it's good. Quite clear, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
I'm sure that there are other participants who would like to ask more questions. I would like to request our participants to come up with their queries and questions for our resource person. Sir, if there are no questions from the participants, may I ask one, sir?
Sure, please.
Sir, I would like to have a clearer understanding about the ritornello effect.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Could you please, sir?
Yeah. You see, ritornello is a musical refrain. You can also use the word, you can substitute the word with refrain. What does a refrain do in a poem? A refrain, like, say, for example, if you can cite, if I may be allowed to cite W.B. Yeats' poem Easter 1916, that famous refrain, all changed utterly, a terrible beauty is born. So it's a long poem, and at the end of every stanza, all changed utterly, a terrible beauty is born. In poetry, poets sometimes use refrains to highlight an emotion. Okay, in the field of music, musicians use refrain to highlight the predominant emotional quotient in a musical composition. In cinema, in popular cinema, whenever you have the hero appearing on screen, a particular tune or a particular beat plays, which will immediately make the audience stand up or start whistling, welcoming the advent of the hero. So this is what you call ritornello, or a musical strain, or the use of a musical beat, which will familiarize the audience, the spectator, with a certain desired emotional impact, or a sort of a situation which demands a certain kind of an attention. Okay, so the word ritornello originally is a musical term, but Deleuze and Guattari import that term into literature. And in the context of literature, in the context of literature studies, literature, every work of literature affects you through ritornalizing, through sort of stimulating an emotion, to stimulating a sort of a nostalgia in which you find yourself in the work in some form. So, you know, you start territorializing yourself. Okay, in literature, all literary works, to some extent or the other, you know, has this ritornel effect. It evokes certain connections. Okay, and these connections generate affects. And we as readers or spectators emotionally react on account of those connections. Okay, and this is exactly what Bharat Muni in the Natya Shastra calls rasa. You know, it's a relish of being connected with a sort of an emotion. Am I clear, Patriot?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I mean, why do you say, for example, when you're watching when you're watching an extremely sad moment on screen, why do you cry, or why are you touched? There is something which which affects you.
Yes, sir.
Okay,
something it appeals to our senses. Yes.
You would not want to experience that in real life. Say a very moving moment when a son has to part with his mother. You would not want to, go through that moment. But in art, you relish it. It creates a ritornello effect. It strikes a chord somewhere. I don't know if I made sense or not.
Definitely, sir.
Yes, I have a question. I can see a question.
Yes, yes.
Nurul Huda, you said that post-theory condition has created an ambivalent sort of condition for the prospective researchers. How would you see the statement? Yes, definitely. The post-theory condition has definitely created a sort of an ambivalence here. Because, we, as I told you, that we have to be dependent upon, the third party of critical theory, the third parties of critical theory. We cannot do away with critical theory at all. Obviously, we cannot, because we have to take into consideration when we are studying, a work which is, which is a product of, say, partition. Obviously, we have to take into account the conditions which somehow engendered the partition. So we have to take into account, certain structural standpoints which are part of the critical theory. But at the same time, the ambivalence lies in the fact that the time has come for us to make an attempt to somewhat not just surrender our interpretations to critical theory.
Can I ask you a question, sir?
Yes, please.
Sir, has Bharat Muni somewhere suggested ways to come out of Jugupsa, that Stai Bhava that you mentioned in his Natyashastra?
Yes, no, I'll tell you what. Bharat Muni does not do that, because Bharat Muni's Natyashastra is just a sort of a compendium.
Yeah.
Okay, it's just a sort of a compendium. Bharat Muni is not at all interpretive. Bharat Muni never interprets his theory. Yeah. The interpretations are to be found in the commentaries on the Natyashastra. So you have to read Abhinava Gupta's Abhinava Bharati.
Okay, thank you. That's okay. Fine. Yeah, that's true. Thank you, sir. It was an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Patriot, you can call the chairperson. Patriot, you are muted.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for a truly astounding lecture on today's topic. And I definitely hope that our chairperson would have a lot of observations on your presentation today. And therefore, now I would like to request and invite our chairperson for today, Dr. Sanjay Kumar Singh, who is an assistant dean as well as the professor at O.P. Jindal University, Raigarh. Sir has more than 16 years teaching and administrative experience, and his area of specialization is Indian writing in English and ELT. He has conducted many corporate training programs and delivered keynotes, visiting lectures as resource person on leadership skills, team building, time management, emotional intelligence, corporate social responsibility, business etiquettes, professional development, communication skills, IWE, ELT, soft skills, disaster management, and human rights, etc. Dr. Singh has organized one international conference, four national conferences, three national workshops, one national colloquium, one national seminar, nine national level tech fests, 10 workshops under faculty development program, and many workshops for students, and also participated as resource persons and paper presenters in more than 72 national, international conferences and seminars. Sir has translated a translation project assigned by People's Linguistic Survey of India in 2013. Sir is a member of many professional associations and reviewer of journals. He has edited Quest, a quarterly news bulletin, Young Professional, a monthly magazine for youths, Prabhat, a literary tabloid, and six books, Subaltern Voices in Indian English Novels, among others. And Sir is also the recipient of the 13 distinguished awards, such as Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam Award, among others. And he has also received the honorary degree of Acharya and many more. It is indeed my pleasure to invite our resource person who shall be delivering his observations on our resource person's talk. I would like to request Dr. Sanjay Kumar Singh, our chairperson, to take this time. So,
thank you, Patriot. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Before going ahead, I would like to show my heartfelt gratitude to ASPEL and Dr. Ghanshyam sir for giving me this opportunity. Dr. Parthasarathy, before I comment, I would like to comment, I would like to read the comment of one scholar who has written in the chat box. And I think that will be enough to say something. He writes here, Mr. Nurul, this lecture is an atomic bomb to be exploded on prospective researchers. Wonderful, really happy. I think this is the thing which says something apart from my observations. Everything has given here. I don't know what he wants to say through this atomic bomb to be exploded, whether it's in the negative or positive. He has to explain in nature later on. But really, it's wonderful, sir. And in meanwhile, you said somewhere that it may be boring, something like that. But really, it was not boring, but it was very informative and presented in really a very interesting way. I can say that this lecture can affect everybody's research in future, and specifically the research work of the prospective researchers, those who are the newcomers. It is true that people worry about being original nowadays, and the theory of anxiety is saying the same. It may happen, but if the coursework, I think you said that focus on research question, and really you have exemplified the things in such a way that, and when you said reading must dictate a methodology, I think these two statements, that focus on research question and reading must dictate methodology, it says what is the importance of coursework in PhD.
Very true.
Earlier, I think people, whether they don't know or not, they don't know. Because sometimes they think these 6 months, they are just futile. Why we have to go through this? But naturally, because you said these two things, really they are focusing, and they can be focused with the help of coursework. The second thing, which I really I appreciate, not I'm going to tell about the narcotic theory and so on, but second thing which you said, researcher must be familiar to one or two other disciplines apart from his own discipline. And it can be done only during coursework. So if they really seriously can do it sincerely, if researchers sincerely go through their, they pursue their coursework, really they can go through the other subjects, and that reading can dictate their methodology, and really they can focus on the research. I think this way we can say, one by one by one, they can find out their path. And sometimes really I say, so I think yesterday also I was telling my scholar that the PhD is just that first step of your research, that you learn there how to do research, how to pursue your things. After that, that is for the sake of your degree, but after that you can start flourishing. So originality, you can be away from the nostalgia, because nostalgia is everywhere. And as you said, eternal, same thing. It happens with everybody whenever he or she writes. As you said, ek bar but se lamha gira kahin, waha daastan mili, lamha kahin nahi. It is true. When, wherever we are, catharsis is there. Whenever we watch a movie, whenever we watch any theater, any serial, we cry. Why? Something because of what? Catharsis. Because that is inside us. And when we both come up to the same level, it happens. So your lecture, really, sir. And one more thing which I appreciate specifically, that is evolutionary approach. I think sometimes we say, go, when a student come to us and we say, okay, find out, prepare one outline. But again, I'm pointing out, coursework can tell you, yes, you have to go for evolutionary approach. Read, read, and read. Your areas, your certainly correlated disciplinary areas, and then you can go for evolutionary approach, that how to write the thesis and how to go for the research. And what I liked most, with the help of your Jew, that is, we are disconnecting. Because, and I think you will be agree with me, this connection is because of degree. We want degree first. Only I think out of 100, maybe 20%, 25%, those who are by passion, that yes, they want to do something. Because most of the people, they want job, and PhD is for the research is for the sake of degree. That's why there is disconnection. If we are passionate, I don't think there will be such kind of thing which the polar bear Joe, that video has shown. So I request all the researchers and those who are the supervisors also, let's please develop the reading of habit first in your scholars. Tell them, read it. Tell them to read the ancillary or auxiliary disciplines subjects, so that they can really fly. They may have wings. Only focusing one subject and then thinking about other things, I don't think, because we are living in a society, and society has many prospects, many areas where we want to work. And if we correlate society's matter, really, which we are experiencing, it can help to find out, you can say, to get a good result and a good kind of original research work also. And anxiety of the theory of anxiety, I think, influence. We can go away from this. Yeah, it will be there. Anyhow, it will be there. And nowadays, that affects most of the people because of the research guides also. So my problem is that people are not willing to read. They are in very hurry, that they want everything very fast. So I request all the people, and sir has also said, I think his lecture, those who have listened to him, they can feel that yes, we all have to read. without reading, you cannot find out the words. We cannot find out the theory. You cannot learn anything. Only superficial learning will not help you. So thank you, Dr. Parsarthi, for giving such good kind of lecture, which is really atoming work to be exploded like that, as Nurul has said. And from my side also, I'm really very happy that I am a part of this. And it will create an impact on my researchers also. I hope so. So with this, again, once again, thank you. And thank you, everyone, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah. It was very nice to listen to you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir, for your insightful observation on our resource person's deliberation.
I think, sir, today we can tell all the supervisors, please ask students to focus on their coursework. Seriously, yeah. And yes, this is the message which I can give you today with the help of the lecture. Yeah. Thank you. Sorry. Yeah, Pat.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Go ahead, please.
Thank you very much, sir, for your observations. And definitely today's insightful deliberation as well as observations have been truly enlightening for all our participants. And although many more questions would have come, however, we are tied by our time schedule, and therefore we will have to cater to that also. So, sir, if you allow me now, may I hand over this session to the moderator of today's session, Dr. Humaira Qureshi.
Yes, please.
Madam, Dr. Humaira Qureshi, would you like to take this from here?
Yeah.
Hello. Is she there?
Yeah,
I think she's there. I just got a response from Madam.
Yes. Thank you so much. Patriot man.
I think she has.
I'm just trying to on my video, but certain due to yeah. Ma'am, I think now I have to proceed towards voter files and distribution of certificates.
Yes.
Ganjam, sir,
yes,
of time.
Yes.
Formal
yes,
voter files.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Before that, you can ask Mr. Pramod Bhengle to present the certificates.
Fine. So now I request Pramod Dhingle, sir, to present certificates to our honorable chief speaker, keynote speaker, and to our chief guest and master of ceremony, Mrs. Patriot Deborma. So over to Dhingle, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Ganjam, sir.
Yes, I'm here.
I share the screen, you announce the names.
Right. So, Parsarthi, sir, it was really a very happy Sunday satsang. Indeed, we are delighted. And research has to be taken in a very formative and, moreover, in a very passionate way. At the same time, coursework is not coursework, but we have to work the course. It has to be taken the other way around. We have to work for the course. And if we can do that, then definitely research will come into the limelight and into the center. Thank you very much for enlightening us on this very important topic. And ISPEL is honored to have you on our platform. And this is a small token which we can offer you for your diligent talk and the Sunday evening. This certificate goes to Parsarthi Gupta ji, Department of English, Tripura University, Agartala. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you so much.
And then Dr. Sanjay Kumar Singh, who is always helpful as far as ISPEL is concerned and a long-standing friend of mine. Indeed, very wonderful researcher. And what I could guess out of these two photographs, which I could see now, at the back of Dr. Parsarthi and at the back of Dr. Sanjay Singh, the same kind of an ambience. So the chief speaker and the chairperson both have the same kind of an ambience. That's really wonderful. So thank you very much, Dr. Sanjay, for sharing your wonderful thoughts with us. And this certificate goes to the Master of Ceremonies from Udaipur, Tripura, Ms. Petria Deberma. For anchoring this wonderful session in a very lucid way. Thank you, Patriot. And in between, there was net connectivity was disturbed and we couldn't even listen to Humaira Qureshi, but she tried her level best and she was there from the beginning till the end, being the moderator of this wonderful session. So Dr. Humaira Qureshi, this certificate goes to you. So thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Over to Humaira Qureshi.
Thank you so much, sir. The essence of all beautiful art is gratitude. So on this note, first of all, I would like to thank Almighty for all his plans to bring ISFIL to elevate and look into the progress of ISFIL as a family. So let's thank God for that. Qualitative progress of education is in our hand, and thus such e-seminars are the necessity of the hour, which will definitely fulfill the motto of ISFIL, facilitate to elevate. In the long journey of ISFIL, as always, even today's session was as wonderful and fruitful. I, on behalf of ISFIL's family, would like to propose hearty vote of thanks to our most valued invited chief speaker, Dr. Parthasarathy Gupta, sir, Department of English, Tripura University, Agartala, for gracing today's e-seminar. Thank you, sir, for your very interesting, thought-provoking, and knowledge-enhancing address. I thank you, sir, for all the words of wisdom that you radiated, a source of energy within us as guide, as research scholars. So the way you explained the topic was truly exemplary. Very well explained, literary research, and especially like retonal, the effects of it. So I'm 101% sure that today's content will be echoed in our minds, especially the upcoming research and scholars, for a long time to come. Thank you, sir, even for answering all the queries of our participants so satisfactorily. I further extend my profound gratitude to Chairperson Dr. Sanjay Kumar Singh, sir, for sparing his valuable time and making himself available for the event. Thank you, sir, for enlightening us with your thoughts and observation. It was indeed a pleasure listening to you. A special mention and gratitude to the event coordinator, Mr. Pramod Dengley, sir, EC member, ISFIL, for being the pillar behind the event and coordinating so very well for the smooth running of the event. Thank you, sir. I express my sincere gratitude with honor to Dr. G.A. Ghanshyam, sir, for giving me this platform and opportunity to extend my service to ISFIL, as I wish to be a part of it, as I've earlier also rendered such services in other many platforms. Thank you, Ghanshyam, sir, for this wonderful opportunity and to be amongst all these great personalities and intellectuals. I'm really very blessed that being an English professor, I'm here a part of this and definitely will be a part of ISFIL in future too. Thank you so much, sir, for being such an efficient captain of ship ISFIL, I must say, and giving it the right direction to it towards the voyage of success. Thank you so much, sir. I also like to express my gratitude to President Dr. Jyoti Patil, ma'am, for all the hard work, patience, and motivation for making ISFIL sail in the smooth manner in the ocean of eminent intellectuals, apart from adding colors to the event. Thank you so much, ma'am. I'm also thankful to our Master of Ceremony for conducting the event so efficiently. Last but not the least, I express a big thankfulness to all the participants present on this platform on Zoom, YouTube, and Facebook page live for their patience, listening, and active participation. Hope each one of us before logging off will be like loaded with a lot of treasure in our minds regarding literary research. So I once again thank all of you for your cordial cooperation. Thank you. Goodbye. Stay healthy and safe. So over to Ghansham sir.
Yeah, Pramod.
Thank you so much.
Yes. So I end the meeting.
Thank you.
With the permission
okay, thank
of
you.
Professor Jay.
All of you, stay safe, stay healthy.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
sir, for today's event.